A concept I usually refer to at this point is the idea of the Anna Karenina principle, where the idea is that, you know, all grants, all happy grants look the same, but there are many, many ways for grants to go awry. I think that's sort of the paraphrase of it. And so there really is kind of a formula. So I'm going to try and zero you in on the formula. You should start to wrap your mind around the actual application itself. You know, what is the product that you're putting in? And this is where you get to have your intellectual and creative input into these few pages. If you're doing a resubmission, which you usually will, usually you submit and then usually you resubmit. That's the course for most applications. Most applications don't get paid on their first time in. So you get one page to reply directly to the reviewers, and you almost always start that with, "We want to thank the esteemed reviewers for those well-thought comments." And you make a very gracious and well-thought-out, non-combative response, right? It's not the time to get into a piss-and-match, because you will lose, because they are there and you're not. Then specific aims, I believe we mentioned that. For an R03, you only get 6 pages. For an R01, you only get 12 pages. Don't try and cheat with the font. Don't try and cheat with the margins. Don't try and crowd it all in there so it's punishing to read. Make sure you have enough white space so it's, you know, legible and readable and easy on the eyes. You have to make sure you've covered protection of human subjects. You can ruin a grant with inadequate attention to human subjects. Doesn't mean this is different from your IRB. This is recognizing the 4 points, and I'm not going to go through them, but there are 4 points in protections of human subjects: risks, benefits, protections. And so you have to make sure all of those are covered. It's not your IRB. IRB approval will be guaranteed, but that's a local issue. We don't care about your consent forms. We don't care about, you know, any of those. Those are guaranteed by your local IRB. But we do care that all these protections are in place. Inclusions absolutely have to be there. You should not save that for the last minute. All these numbers have to add up. You know, if you have, you know, all these different racial and ethnic minorities included, they have to add up at the bottom. You have like these complicated charts you have to figure out, and those are congressionally mandated. So get somebody who's done that before so that you can get an idea of, don't try and figure it out by yourself because it's really nonsensical, but it's required. You have to include children, which for purposes of NIH, children are under the age of 21, not 18. You have to explain why you're not including children. If you're including some children, like 18 to 21 is very common to include those children because you're running your undergrads, then you're including children, but you still have to talk about why you're not including children below 18. It's fine. You just have to cover that base. Same thing, you know, it's also parallel with vertebrate animals that, there are various assurances you have to provide in the care and use of vertebrate animals. Letters of support, we talked about a lot. Appendix, really, you can't do much with appendix. It's a vestigial organ from grants gone by. I mean, the appendix used to be a place where you could stack in all kinds of stuff. The problem is when the page limits got cut in half, went from 25 to 12 pages, people just started shoving everything it used to be in those other 13 pages into the appendices. That's not where they belong. They were using it to circumvent the limits, and we commonly send grants back unreviewed for violating these appendix guidelines. About the only thing you can put in there would be things like the actual test itself that would be like a non-standard test. It's a test that's commonly available. You just name the test. You don't have to include a copy of the test. You can, but it's just irritating. But a test that isn't commonly available, a manuscript that is published or in press but not available. So there aren't very many of these. No. That's worth mentioning, and the word is no, that you cannot use any links in your application. So another common problem is people will refer to links, the URLs in their application. It's very tempting to do that, right? You want to just do, it's all, you know, all the grants are distributed electronically anyway, might as well put in a hyperlink. And we explicitly warn reviewers not to go to hyperlinks because they are, ultimately they're all trackable, so it violates the anonymity of the application. It can be used to exceed the page limitations. It puts on an unfair reviewer burden. So you can't depend on links. You shouldn't include them. That said, it's really wonderful in your references cited when you can put in the, I never remember this, the DOID. So you put that in and let people click through the references that way. That's awesome. Those go out to public databases, and those are publicly available references, and you've made it much easier for reviewers, so they love you for it.
And the new biosketch format, you know, you need to include like your library pages where you have all your publications.
MCBI.
Right. So, so often reviewers are just pointed towards that page of yours where they can get them.
Yeah, that's a great point. So, so if you haven't started working on your new biosketch, it's really PHS 398 submitted through SF 424. You should do that. That thing takes a long time. If you have your existing biosketch and you haven't changed it over yet, start working on it now. It's challenging. But for now, the thing it really forces you to do, I think, is to go through and create your PubMed bibliography. The thing you have to recognize about the PubMed bibliography is that you really can't put anything in that you can't tie to a grant, a federal grant. The thing that motivates PubMed, that requires PubMed, is that federal funds have paid for research, and the idea is that research then needs to be made available to taxpayers. So that's PubMed's intent. So it can be difficult to upload things, especially for new investigators who haven't had things that were directly funded. But if you were on a training grant, if you were on an R01, if you worked as a research assistant on an R01, you can tie your work to that grant sometimes reasonably. So, you know, it's not really a problem to stretch a little bit to try and tie your work to previous federal funding. So I'd encourage you to do that. You can also, there are some others, I can't remember offhand. Does anybody remember what the other electronic databases are that are allowed in the new biosketch? PubMed's the most limited one, but there are others. So PubMed's the one my NCBI and PubMed are the same thing.
Sorry. Is it valued or not to cite, let's say, your own work that is under review? Or is that the same as it not just being published?
Oh, that's a great question. So under review is a tricky category. For early stage investigators, you can do it. For more established investigators, it's actually forbidden.
Okay.
So when you put it in the running text, I think you can get away with it, but you can't put it in your bio sketch is where it gets problematic.
Oh, okay. So,
but I think it's good in the AIMS to say recent preliminary experiments in our lab have demonstrated this. And
right.
You know, recognizing that it's unsubstantiated and unpeer-reviewed, you can't lean on it too hard, but,
right. Okay.
I don't have a problem with putting it out there.
So that would be, I guess, for early investigators, as you said, for K-23, that would not be offensive, at
no,
least.
No, that would be a great
okay.
thing to do, actually. Yeah, and actually, you're going to do that if you have those preliminary results. You're going to put those in your research plan anyway, right?
Right, okay.
There used to be something about if you had a manuscript that got accepted between the time of submission and review.
So there's such a long time between the submission deadline and the review. There's a period in there where you might have, and it often happens it happens all the time, where you have a manuscript that's under review and gets accepted during the time between the time you've submitted and the time that the manuscript is being reviewed. For fellowships, it's particularly important that you notify your review officer of that. And so when you go on Commons, one of the people that are listed in the Commons page is your review officer. and you can shoot them an email. You can. I actually like to get a PDF of the accepted paper, and a letter that the email from the editor indicating acceptance, because people aren't always honest about this, and so it's nice to have the evidence. And so, of course, you're all honest, but you have to recognize it's a competition and there are people out there that will be dishonest. So don't make the grant review officer come back to you and say, you know, would you please provide documentation that this is in fact true? So in the research strategy, that's the 6 to 12 pages, and it has to do a lot of different things. And I would just, you know, sort of refer you to this list as a starting way to think about them. The narrative used to be something that had prescribed parts: introduction, preliminary studies, research plan, and that's not the case anymore. Those 6 or 12 pages are very free form. You still want to include those elements of background and the research plan and things we talked about yesterday fully fleshed out. But how you do it is kind of up to you. If you want to include preliminary studies as part of the background, if you want to sort of work things, you know, integrate things a little bit more, you can. And they tend to follow a much more traditional organization, though, where it's introduction, you know, research plan, and always ending with a timeline. Do not forget to do this timeline. It's not mentioned in the application guide, but it's pretty much a required element, including in the timeline plans for dissemination along the way. So let's see if there's anything else I have to... Feasibility, I think I mentioned. Oh, synthetic data. So I wanted to... So a great thing to do, if you have feasibility but you don't have enough data to show how you treat the data, you can just create a synthetic data set, you know, raw data, and then run the raw data, and, you know, you're telling them it's synthetic, right? We made up this data set, we ran it completely through our analysis, and here's what the results showed. It's awesome. That is so compelling. You can show a graph or two or three graphs that show alternate outcomes, how they'll be interpreted, what the statistics were that got you there. You know, the experiment's all done. All you have to do then is fill it in with real data. It's very, very, very compelling. I mean, you see grants that do that, and it's just like you've gone into another world because it's just so well thought out. And feasibility in that case is not even a question, right? All you have to know in that case is what was the, you know, how long does it take to acquire and process and finesse the data to get it to, you know, into the form you need.